Majjhima Nikaya Sutta number 13, Mahadukkha Kanda Sutta, the greater discourse on the mess of suffering. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, Anathapindika's park. Then when it was morning, a number of monks dressed and taking their bowls and outer robes went into Savati for alms. Then they thought, it is still too early to wander for alms in Savati. Suppose we went to the park of the wanderers of other sects. So they went to the park of the wanderers of other sects and exchanged greetings with the wanderers. When this courteous and amiable talk was finished, they sat down at one side. The wanderers said to them, friends, the recluse Gotama describes the full understanding of sensual pleasures, and we do so too. The recluse Gotama describes the full understanding of material form, and we do so too. The recluse Gotama describes the full understanding of feelings, and we do so too. What then is the distinction here, friends? What is the variance? What is the difference between the recluse Gotama's teaching of the Dhamma and ours, between his instructions and ours? Then those monks neither approved nor disapproved of the wondrous words. Without doing either, they rose from their seats and went away, thinking, we shall come to understand the meaning of these words in the Blessed One's presence. When they had wandered for alms in Savati and had returned from their alms round, after the meal they went to the Blessed One, and after paying homage to him, they sat down at one side and told him what had taken place. The Blessed One said, monks, wanderers of other sects who speak thus should be questioned thus. But friends, what is the gratification, what is the danger, and what is the escape in the case of sensual pleasures? What is the gratification, what is the danger, and what is the escape in the case of material form or body? What is the gratification, what is the danger, and what is the escape in the case of feelings? Being questioned thus, wanderers of other sects will fail to account for the matter, and what is more, they will get into difficulties. Why is that? Because it is not their province. Monks, I see no one in the world with its gods, its maras and its brahmas, in this generation with its recluses and brahmins, with its princes and its people, who could satisfy the mind with a reply to these questions, except for the Tathagata or his disciple or one who has learned it from them. And what, monks, is the gratification in the case of sensual pleasures? Monks, there are these five courts of sensual pleasure. What are the five? Forms cognizable by the eye that are wished for, desired, agreeable and likable, connected with sensual desire and provocative of lust. Sounds cognizable by the ear, odors cognizable by the nose, flavors cognizable by the tongue, tangibles cognizable by the body, that are wished for, desired, agreeable and likable, connected with sensual desire and provocative of lust. These are the five causes of sensual pleasure. Now the pleasure and joy that arise dependent on these five causes of sensual pleasure are the gratification in the case of sensual pleasures. Let's stop here for a moment. So the gratification or satisfaction of sensual pleasures is the pleasure and joy that arises from enjoying these five chords of sensual pleasure, namely forms, sounds, odors, flavors, tangibles. And what, monks, is the danger in the case of sensual pleasures? Here, monks, on account of the craft by which a clansman makes a living, whether checking or accounting or calculating or farming or trading or husbandry or archery or the royal service, or whatever craft it may be, he has to face cold, he has to face heat, he is injured by contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, sun and creeping things. He risks death by hunger and thirst. Now this is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, a mass of suffering visible here and now, having sensual pleasures as its cause, sensual pleasures as its source, sensual pleasures as its basis, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says, because of sensual pleasures, everybody wants sensual pleasures to have a good life. So do you have to make a living? Whether you make a living by accounting or farming or soldier or whatever it is, you have to face cold, heat, mosquitoes, snakes and risk your life. So this is a danger of sensual pleasures. If no property comes to the clansman while he works and strives and makes an effort, thus he sorrows, grieves and laments. He weeps, beating his breast, and becomes distraught, crying, "My work is in vain, my effort is fruitless." Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures. I'll stop here for a moment. This, for example, in those days of the Buddha, farmers, they work on the fields, and then because of drought, no rain, and their whole crop, all the crops are wiped out. Or if there's a flood, excessive rain, all the crops are wiped out. So they will suffer, they grieve. Nowadays, it will be like a businessman, invest a lot of money, and then because of recession, all your business goes bankrupt, and you also will sorrow and grieve. If no property comes to the clansman while he works and strives and makes an effort, thus he experiences pain and grief in protecting it. How shall neither kings nor thieves make off with my property, nor fire burn it, nor water sweep it away, nor hateful airs make off with it? And as he guards and protects his property, kings or thieves make off with it, or fire burns it, or water sweeps it away, or hateful airs make off with it. And he sorrows, grieves and laments. He weeps, beating his breast, and becomes distraught, crying, "What I had, I have no longer." Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. Stop here for a moment. So if a man, he works, and then he acquires wealth, he acquires property, he has to worry about it, whether bandits or robbers will come and rob him. Or in those days, kings were very powerful. They can simply seize your property. Or maybe, like in certain places, they have warlords. Then they simply just take what they want. Or even ordinary things like fire may burn your property, or flood. And hateful as relatives also try to steal your property. And if they do, then you will grieve also. Again, with sensual pleasures as the cause, sensual pleasures as the source, sensual pleasures as the basis, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. Kings quarrel with kings, nobles with nobles, Brahmins with Brahmins, householders with householders, mother quarrels with child, child with mother, father with child, child with father, brother quarrels with brother, sister with sister, sister with brother, friend with friend. And here in their quarrels, brawls and disputes, they attack each other with fists, clots, sticks or knives, whereby they incur death or deadly suffering. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. So stop here for a moment. So here also, because of wealth, because of property division, because of jealousy, because of covetousness, people quarrel each other, and relatives also quarrel each other. In those days, if things cannot be settled, then they come to blows and take knives and all that. But nowadays, they go to court. See you in court, they say. Again, with sensual pleasures as the cause, men take swords and shields and buckle on bows and quivers, and they charge into battle amassed in double array, with arrows and spears flying and swords flashing. And there they are wounded by arrows and spears, and the heads are cut off by swords, whereby they incur death or deadly suffering. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. So again, for the same reason, jealousy and covetousness and all this, and then men fight with each other. Again, with sensual pleasures as the cause, men take swords and shields and buckle on bows and quivers, and they charge slippery bastions with arrows and spears flying and swords flashing. And there they are wounded by arrows and spears and splashed with boiling liquids and crushed under heavy weights, and their heads are cut off by swords, whereby they incur death or deadly suffering. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. This is referring to war and all that, because of greed, because of wanting material things. Men fight with each other. Sometimes people, because their race is different, they fight. Sometimes because religion is different, they fight. Sometimes because the nation is different, they fight. Again, with sensual pleasures as the cause, men break into houses, plunder wealth, commit burglary, ambush highways, seduce others' wives. And when they are caught, kings have many kinds of torture inflicted on them. The kings have them flogged with whips, beaten with canes, beaten with clubs. They have their hands cut off, their feet cut off, their hands and feet cut off, their ears cut off, their noses cut off, their ears and noses cut off. They have them subjected to the polished pot, that means they are cooked in the pot, to the polished shell shave, to the rahu's mouth, to the fiery reed, to the flaming hand, to the blades of grass, to the bark dress, to the antelope, to the meat hooks. Probably they are hung up, like the chicken or the duck. To the coins, to the live pickling, to the pivoting pin, to the rolled up lace. And they have them splashed with boiling oil. And they have them thrown to be devoured by dogs. And they have them impaled alive on stakes. And they have their heads cut off with swords, whereby they incur death or deadly suffering. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. Here it refers to people who break the precepts. They steal or they seduce others' wives and they do other things that break the law. Because of that, they are caught by the kings, by the soldiers, and they are subjected to all kinds of torture. In the Buddha's days, the king was all-powerful, can torture you any way they like. There's one sutta where the king wanted to see whether a man has a soul. And when they have some criminal that is caught and supposed to be killed, the king asked the soldiers to cut off his skin bit by bit to see whether the soul comes out of the body. And then they found they didn't see any soul. Then next time they caught another criminal, then they put him in a pot, close the pot and boil the water and then see whether anything come out. So all kinds of ways they can do, as the king likes in those days. They can cut off your flesh bit by bit. All that. So that is what happens when people break the law and they are caught. Again, with sensual pleasures as the cause, sensual pleasures as the source, sensual pleasures as the basis, the cause being simply sensual pleasures, people indulge in misconduct of body, speech and mind. Having done so, on the dissolution of the body after death, they reappear in states of deprivation, in an unhappy destination, in perdition, even in hell. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, a mass of suffering in the life to come. Having sensual pleasures as its cause, sensual pleasures as its source, sensual pleasures as its basis, the cause being simply sensual pleasures. So here, because of wanting to enjoy ourselves, we go to various extent and we break the precepts. We misconduct ourselves in body, speech and mind, create bad karma to these three ways, and then after that we end up in the woeful plains of existence and suffer for a long time. And what monks is the escape in the case of sensual pleasures? It is the removal of desire and lust, the abandonment of desire and lust for sensual pleasures. This is the escape in the case of sensual pleasures. That those recluses and Brahmins who do not understand as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger and as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of sensual pleasures, can either themselves fully understand sensual pleasures or instruct another so that he can fully understand sensual pleasures. That is impossible. That those recluses and Brahmins who understand as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of sensual pleasures, can either themselves fully understand sensual pleasures or instruct another so that he can fully understand sensual pleasures. That is possible. And just stop here for a moment to quote a simile given in another sutta. This is a very interesting simile given by the Buddha, I think in the Magandhya Sutta, which you will come across later in the book. In this sutta, the Buddha gave a simile for sensual pleasures, saying that people indulge in sensual pleasures to enjoy the five causes of sensual pleasure, to forms, sounds, smells, tastes and touch. And the Buddha said, people who do this. Sometimes people's sensual desires are very strong. They go to extreme extent to satisfy the sensual pleasures. And the Buddha gave a simile of a leper. Buddha says, leper, you know, the flesh is all rotting and it's very itchy. And so the Buddha said, this leper, because the skin is all eaten by all these worms or bacteria, whatever, so he has so much itch, he has to scratch, and keep scratching and keep scratching. And he scratches to ease the itch. But each time he scratches, the blood comes out. The more he scratches, more blood comes out. Then it turns to pus, and then becomes very foul smelling. But then the skin is so rotten that even scratching cannot satisfy that itch. So what does he do? He cannot stand. He go and find some burning ember, charcoal. Go and burn the flesh. And then only he can sigh. Can ease the itch. But then as he does this, then the flesh becomes more rotten because it's burned. And then more pus and more foul smelling. But he continues to do this. He has no choice. So the more he does it, the more the worse the body becomes. More pus, more blood comes out, and more bad smelling and all that. But he has to continue doing it. So the Buddha said, if an ordinary person without leprosy, suppose we were to do the same thing to that person, scratch until his blood comes out, how would he feel? Pain, isn't it? Or take a burning ember and burn him, he feel pain. Now why does not this leper feel pain? Because he's sick, the Buddha says. Because he's sick. So because he's a sick person, the skin is different from an ordinary person's skin. So his skin is like deadened like that. He scratch. Also he does not feel the pain. His only thing in his mind is that itch. The itch which he needs to satisfy. Like a drug addict like that. So this makes us realize actually this sensual desire is a sickness like that. It's just an itch we need to satisfy. Now we come to material form or body. And what monks is the gratification in the case of material form? Suppose there were a girl of the noble class or the Brahmin class or of householder stock in her 15th or 16th year, neither too tall nor too short, neither too thin nor too fat, neither too dark nor too fair. Is her beauty and loveliness then at its height? Yes, venerable sir. Now the pleasure and joy that arise in dependence on that beauty and loveliness are the gratification in the case of material form. I'll stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says that gratification or satisfaction in the case of material form or body, this must be rupa, body, is a young girl at her height of her beauty, when she's about 15 or 16 years old. So when you see a beautiful girl like that, the pleasure and joy that arise because of that is the gratification in the case of material form. Like nowadays, would be people seeing the Miss Universe contest, seeing all the beautiful girls. And what monks is the danger in the case of material form? Later on, one might see that same woman here at 80, 90 or 100 years old, aged, as crooked as a roof bracket, doubled up, supported by a walking stick, tottering, frail, her youth gone, her teeth broken, grey hair, scanty head, bald, wrinkle, all limbs all blotchy. What do you think, monks? Has her former beauty and loveliness vanished and the danger become evident? Yes, venerable sir. Monks, this is a danger in the case of material form or body. I'll stop here for a moment. So you imagine a beautiful girl you saw at 16 years old and 70 or 80 years later you look at her, she's become an old woman, almost bald already, no teeth, the hair, a lot of it dropped off, and skin or wrinkle, and every step that she takes also, with effort, and hunchback. So that beautiful young girl has become this ugly old lady. It's the same person. Again, one might see that same woman, afflicted, suffering, and gravely ill, lying foul in her own excrement, and urine lifted up by some and set down by others. What do you think, monks? Has her former beauty and loveliness vanished and the danger become evident? Yes, venerable sir. Monks, this too is a danger in the case of material form. So even if that woman does not grow old, sometimes she might get sick with cancer or any serious sickness. And you see her, even though she's young, but she's lying on the bed, cannot move on her own, and sleeping on her own, urine and excrement. Other people have to feed her, clean her, and all these things. And all her beauty, all gone. Years ago, when I was new to Buddhism, we had one of our lady Buddhist friends. She had a sickness in the, I think the kidney or urine, or this liver was having problem. So few of our Buddhist friends went to the hospital to donate blood for her. And I saw her all yellow and so thin. So I had to change the blood. So the beautiful girl suddenly, with the onset of sickness, can become ugly. Again, one might see that same woman as a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, 1, 2, or 3 days dead, bloated, livid, and oozing matter. What do you think, monks? Has her former beauty and loveliness vanished and the danger become evident? Yes, Venerable Sir. Monks, this too is a danger in the case of material form. So that beautiful girl, one day she suddenly dies, and then after 3 days she turns into a corpse, bloated and smelly and blue-black and liquid oozing from the 9 holes. Then that beautiful girl, Miss Universe, has become Miss Corpse. Again, one might see that same woman as a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, being devoured by crows, hawks, vultures, dogs, jackals, or various kinds of worms. And later, it becomes a skeleton with flesh and blood, held together with sinews. And later, a fleshless skeleton smeared with blood, held together with sinews. And later, disconnected bones scattered in all directions. Here a hand bone, there a foot bone, here a thigh bone, there a rib bone, here a hip bone, there a back bone, here the skull. And later it becomes bones bleached white, the color of shells. And later bones heaped up more than a year old. And later bones rotted and crumbled to dust. What do you think, monks? Has her former beauty and loveliness vanished and the danger become evident? Yes, venerable sir. Monks, this too is a danger in the case of material form or body. And what, monks, is the escape in the case of material form? It is a removal of desire and lust, the abandonment of desire and lust for material form. This is the escape in the case of material form. That those recluses and Brahmins who do not understand, as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of material form, can either themselves fully understand material form or instruct another so that he can fully understand material form. That is impossible. That those recluses and Brahmins who understand as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of material form, can either themselves fully understand material form or instruct another so that he can fully understand material form. That is possible. Now we come to feelings. And what, monks, is the gratification in the case of feelings? Here, monks, quite secluded from sensual pleasures, secluded from unwholesome states, a monk enters upon and abides in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thought directed and sustained, with delight and pleasure born of seclusion. On such an occasion, he does not choose for his own affliction, or for another's affliction, or for the affliction of both. On that occasion, he feels only feeling that is free from affliction. The highest gratification in the case of feelings is freedom from affliction, I say. Again, with the stilling of thought directed and sustained, a monk enters upon and abides in the second jhana. And with the fading away as well of delight, he enters upon and abides in the third jhana. Then with the abandoning of pleasure and pain, he enters upon and abides in the fourth jhana. On such an occasion, he does not choose for his own affliction, or for another's affliction, or for the affliction of both. On that occasion, he feels only feeling that is free from affliction. The highest gratification in the case of feelings is freedom from affliction, I say. So here the Sutta is saying that the gratification in the case of feelings, the highest satisfaction is abiding in jhana. When you are in jhana, that's the most pleasurable feeling. And what monks is the danger in the case of feelings? Feelings are impermanent, suffering, subject to change. This is the danger in the case of feelings. In other words, even the jhanas are impermanent, even the heavens are impermanent. And what monks is the escape in the case of feelings? This is the removal of desire and lust, the abandonment of desire and lust for feelings. This is the escape in the case of feelings. That those recluses and Brahmins who do not understand as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of feelings, can either themselves fully understand feelings or instruct another so that he can fully understand feelings. That is impossible. That those recluses and Brahmins who understand as it actually is, the gratification as gratification, the danger as danger, and the escape as escape in the case of feelings, can either themselves fully understand feelings or instruct another so that he can fully understand feelings. That is possible. That is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So this sutta is the way the Buddha explained is very striking, especially like in the first case, the danger of sensual pleasures, that worldly people, because of everybody wanting a good life, we compete with each other, we quarrel, we fight with each other, and even to the extent of killing each other, or because of I and mine, we want to protect our interests. And then the case of body, the danger of body, is the example the Buddha gives, is so striking. Beautiful girl, 16 years old, one day, another day you see her and she's 80 or 90 years old, totally different, beautiful to ugly. And then she's sick, afflicted with a severe illness, lying on her own urine and excrement, then also all the loveliness has vanished. Or she has become a corpse suddenly one day. So then all that. So from these examples you can see that life is impermanent. So whatever beauty any one of us have is only fleeting. Only when we are young, we look beautiful or handsome. As we grow older, we become more and more ugly. So not many people have the wisdom like the Buddha. Buddha said when he was young, he thought to himself, now I'm young. What is there to be proud of being young? He said, one day I have to grow old just like other people. Then he thought, now I have health. I'm young, I have health. What is there to be proud of health? One day when I grow old, I'll become sick. Then again he thought, now I have life. But what is there to be proud of life? One day, life also will slip away from me. Only somebody with wisdom can think like that. But most people in the world, we are very vain. We're vain of our body, we're vain of our possessions and all that. Don't realize all these things are impermanent.